Right, so what we've got here is a browser on the left with the page from MythTV telling us how to build it from source. There's no actual binary package that's released by the MythTV people. So it didn't matter what distribution you build from, it has to be, or sorry, which distribution you want to use MythTV with, you have to build it from source, irrespective. And also I've got a page up with, or a tab with, the Beyond Linux from Scratch page, because we'll be doing stuff from this page as well. So what I'm going to do, although I've got a list of dependencies that need to be installed from Linux from Scratch, what I'm going to do is, after just setting up the environment on the host machine, I'll be trying to install MythTV and see what packages come up that it's demanding, because it's quite good like that. It tells you what's missing from the build and just take it from there. So that's what I've got on the right hand side of the screen, is a terminal which I've got an SSH link directly into, and as you can see there's the 11.3 version of LFS, and the host name of this TV is DTV, for digital TV, I guess. Unfortunately, I haven't got LSPCI, obviously, because this is a basic LFS installation. There's just root on there. There's no user yet, as you'd expect. As I say, it's just what you saw before. It's a bog standard Linux from Scratch build, and then, as you saw before, I built SSH, OpenSSH, and I've just run that to get the connection to it. So you can see there's nothing in home either. It's just purely the basic LFS that we're starting from. So what I'm going to do is to start going through some of the bits and just do some basic configuration. Normally I go through quite diligently and do all the configuration parts and security parts of Beyond Linux from Scratch before going on to build the packages that I need. But because this is a specific reason for building these packages, it's just going to be used for one thing, this PC. I'm just going to do more or less the bare minimum to get things going without doing any sort of fancy stuff or anything, too much fancy stuff, just getting enough going to make it a nice environment to use, but just the minimum to get things going. There's no need for bells and whistles, because it's not going to be an environment the user interacts with. All that interaction is going to be provided by MythTV as part of that build. It's not really going to be a box that people can interact at the command line so much. It's going to be a machine to interact with the front end. So I'm going to jump straight into part 2, chapter 3, the bash shell startup files. So I'll go straight into here. And I'm going to go through this, and what we need to do is just grab the output of the lang variable that was set in, let me move that keyboard. I'm trying to type on the keyboard for the machine itself, and that's obviously not needed because we're on an SSH link. So I'll do cat etc profile, because we're going to create a new profile as we do with BLFS. So this information is what I need, specifically this. I need to remember this information as we go through these bits here, because as you can see, it's going to get overwritten with this base etc profile. So let's copy that and paste that in. And install a directory. and the bash completion script. And right, what's happened there? That hasn't copied properly. Let's try that again. Okay, that's better. Maybe the EOF didn't copy. And that's got a directory as well. Some directory colors. Some extra paths. Some readline configuration. UMask default. Usual set to 22022. And then this profile, this is the bit where we need to add in that lang. So if I scroll up, no, it's gone off the screen now. Okay, what it should be is engb. Yeah, I have forgotten now, haven't I? engb.iso88591. That should be lang equals. And then EOF. So I'll just put that up on screen, that file, so you can see what it should look like. And obviously you put your country code, whatever you've read in for lang, whatever you set in Linux from scratch. So a base bash RC. Okay, that hasn't copied properly again for some reason. Yeah, for some reason it's not copying properly across. Let's try that again. That's better. And a bash profile. And profile. This is obviously for each user. As this was as well, because it's a dot profile. So this will obviously overwrite the defaults are in etc, but we can create them. Profile. I'll just put that. Oh, I could leave that blank actually, and then it will use the default one. That won't, because it's not going to source it by the looks of it. So I'll put that in. En underscore gb dot iso 88591. And one for bash rc, that looks like that takes the lang variable as well. So I'll put that in as well. En gb iso 88591. So these obviously override the global ones, if that's what you want. And there's a bash log out here as well. And dir colors for pretty colors. So if I now re-log in as the root. Oh, so some of them didn't copy properly, did they? Check these files to make sure they do look okay. That looks okay. That might be something to do with this center button not clicking properly, possibly. That looks okay. Okay, it does actually, maybe there's some here to document pending before, but they all seem to have written okay. Let's just check the ETC. Yeah, that looks okay. Obviously, that's working because we've got red on the prompt now anyway. Dir colors. That's going to be a big file. Let's do less on that. Yeah, that looks okay. Yeah, that's okay. It seems to be okay as well. Let's just check. Yeah. Let's check which ones we had again. So profile we've checked. Okay, bash completion. Yeah, that's fine. That looks okay. That looks okay. Yeah, there's nothing immediately obvious. Maybe, like I say, it's one of those here to documents that didn't seem to copy properly. Maybe it was something pending or something or other. Strange. I've never had that before. I'm going to have to be careful when I copy and paste stuff in case there's an inherent problem with this browser, maybe, or this button. Right, so that's okay. I'm also going to add a make file, export make flags equals minus J4. So that make will build on all the cores, and obviously, depending on the number of cores you've got, you may want to change that. So if I become the root again, and I've still got it, so there is something still wrong. Hit document line 19. Right, so it's only on the login. Right, I think what I'll do is I'll put all these in again and just overwrite what's there. It's probably the best thing to do. So that will exist. Yeah, see, that one's not copied right again. I'm not sure if I'm going too far when I'm copying, if it's a strange line or something. let's modify that one. Yeah, actually, that'd be a better idea to do what they've said here is to output it to the SKEL file directory. Sorry. So if I do mkdir, I will do these and then I'll copy them afterwards. Right, let's try that. Right, yeah, it's gone. So it must be one of them files that copied a bit funny. I've never seen that before. I'm going to have to be really careful when I copy and paste stuff. Okay, so let's echo that lang, make sure that's set, because that's obviously important. Yep, that's good. So what I've got to do now is make that... what first we'll do is add that make flags back in to profile, because that'll be useful. Add that to the bottom. So export make make flags equals minus J4, and I'll start yet another session. So echo lang, that's set, and echo make flags, that's set, that's good. So now I'll make the etc skel, and I'll copy dot bash profile dot profile dot bash rc dot bash logout, and I think that's it, into etc skel. So that now means when I create an ordinary user, it will take on those, well, with the right parameter, it will take those files on and create them automatically in the user's home directory. So what I shall do now is to add a user, and I think it's minus M, is it? Yeah, create the home. Kernotex. Okay, and then set the password for Kernotex. Okay. And if I now become Kernotex, I've got a prompt, and you can see those dot files have been copied in for me as well. One, two, three, four. Yeah, that's all of them. So that's good. So that's the super user, the normal user created. I've still got lots of things to do as the root user. And the first thing I need to do is to, we move on a little bit. There's a couple of little things. I don't need to worry about that. We need to install these scripts to ensure that random numbers are truly random between boots. So we need to go to the sources BLFS boot scripts and do make install random, and then we can actually start that off. Random start. Okay, and then what I'm going to do next is to change the ownership of all the files in BLFS so that they're available to Kernotex. So I'm going to change the ownership of, right, I won't change ownership of this directory. I was going to do it recursively, but it may be that these have got to stay as root. So I'm just going to change to use Kernotex own a group Kernotex, although I could probably leave that as root, to be quite honest. I'll change the BLFS directory itself, and then these two packages that have also already been downloaded. Okay. And then I'm going to go back to being Kernotex. CD sources. BLFS, so we've got access to it and we'll be able to write to it as well because the parent directory is owned by Kernotex. So that's the sort of the configuration, or the BLFS side of configuration setup. So there's nothing else to do there. What I've got to do next is to install a basic form of wget, because at the moment we haven't got any easy way to download packages. So let's type in wget. Alright, okay, we need to go up higher. And there it is. So you see it's easy to install wget because there's an FTP link, and FTP is available by default. So all we need to do is to type in FTP and the location, which is, well, just need this bit, ftpgnu.org. So ftp.gnu.org. Name, just put anonymous, and we're in. So next we need to change directories. So we need to change directory to GNU, then wget. And if we type on ls, we can see the files that are there. And we specifically want to get this file here. So we go into binary mode with BI and passive mode as well. Still don't know why that's good, but I always see it recommended to be turned on. I've never actually spent time to look into that, into why that's a good idea, but set it anyway. And then just get, and the name of the file we want to get. There it is. Just quit now. And we should have wget there. And there it is at the bottom. So now we'll extract that, change into it, and we can install it like this and get it basically working. And then what we'll do is start to install more of it, or more of the dependencies such as make CA. Initially, we need to just get something where we can download packages where there isn't an FTP option available, which is quite a few sites, actually. So we're in the wget. Let's now configure and install it, or build it, rather. Let's just see if there's any other options here and should test. No, there isn't. Or set, rather, not test. Now, again, there's specific packages for running the tests. As you can see, there's three there at least for the test suite. I'm still going to run the tests, and if some fail, I'm going to have to see if I can tie up the fact that they failed because these packages are missing, but hopefully the tests are intelligent enough to skip tests if certain packages aren't available. So let's now build this. And that looks like it is probably building with four cores. It's going quite nipply. Okay, let's do a quick check. Yeah, we've got some failures there. Again, like I say, that's, yeah, see, HTTPS, that's very likely to be this, or even this IOSocket SSL package. So not going to worry too much about that. So we need to become the root user. So probably the best way to do this without sudo is to run a command like this. Tell it to become root and run the command in the quotes, which is make install. Type in the root password. Let's try that again. Yep, that's it. Okay, so now we've got wget, can run it, and you can see we've got wget there, so we'll tidy that up. And we can move on, and the next thing I'm actually going to do is to start installing for the dependencies, which start with make CA, because it's going to save a little bit of typing. Virtually every web page these days has got some sort of HTTPS on it, some sort of encryption. So I think it's quite important that we get it going. Okay, let's make this font a little bit bigger. So this needs P11 kit and NSS. Is it the same size font as that? Okay, and NSS needs NSPR and SQLite and P11 kit at runtime, which we've already got. So NSPR and SQLite. And okay, just needs unzip for the documentation. I'm not sure if we do actually need unzip later on, but I'm not going to install it now. Let's see what else we need. That doesn't need anything. P11 kit needs libtazin. There's a recommendation. So let's start with SQLite. So we'll grab that. You can see this is an HTTPS, so what's going to happen is that it's going to fail when we do wget because we haven't got any. Copy link, paste. We haven't got any encryption set in wget yet because we didn't have the right packages, so it does kindly tell us that we can override the fact that we haven't got any encryption by telling it to not check any certificates. So that's allowed us to fetch that. So let's extract SQLite. I'm not bothering with documentation. I'd say it's probably very little point in that. So start by copying this config command. Just check if there's anything else that could be set. No, there isn't. So run that configure and then build the package and wait for it to finish. Okay, so that has compiled. So there's no test suite, just install it, and we use the same command as I did before. Okay, it's done. If downloaded the documentation, no. So that's that package complete. Okay, so let's now do NSPR. Copy that link. Again, we've got to paste in this no certificate. So I'll extract it and then run these commands to configure it. And build it. And once again, install it. And that's that one done. So now we've got NSS to build. Let's copy that. Paste it, and we've got a required patch here as well. Again, we've got this no check certificate, so we can just plonk that in afterwards. So as you can see, the recommended is SQLite or SQLite and P11 kit, which we haven't installed, but it's only at runtime, and we're only obviously installing it at the moment, so that's not a problem. So NSS. So we've got the patch first of all, and then it looks like this big command, there's no configuration, it's just a case of changing directory, and then this make command, single make command, builds the package. Okay, so that's built. It took a little while. I'm going to run the test, which take a lot longer, it says down here. So let's run this. And I'll time this as well. And come back when this is finished. Okay, so that took quite a while to run as it suggested it would. We've got 12 failures. It does say that some will fail on an Intel chip, which is what this is on. There is test results at this location, but unfortunately I haven't got a browser at the moment, not even a text browser. We could try and view it. Okay, that's not quite the right location. Okay, so there it is. Okay, I don't know why that didn't find. Expect failure to list cert. It's quite hard to read without a browser. Okay, looks like I might be looking for the word failed maybe because it says pass there, so let's try that. Okay, there you go, wait for server failed. All right, I did see them near the end where it's trying to start some servers and they failed. That's the name of a test. Yeah, so I think that's probably okay to carry on the miner, given that there's 60-odd thousand run, 66,000, so I'm happy with that. So as the root user, let's just become root like this. We'll install it with all these commands. And that seems to have worked. Let's just check. The last command was to install into user lib package config. Yep, there it is there. So that's okay. If P11 kit is installed, the trust module can be used as drop-in placement. So we should be able to run that. Even though it doesn't exist at the moment, it should be populated when P11 kit's installed. Yep, so it's not going anywhere at the moment, so we'll check that after P11 kit's been installed, which is the next package. So let's tidy this up. And install P11 kit. So this now needs libtazn and make CA, but only at runtime. So let's get that one. Let's come back to the user. Okay. Sorry, I'll do libtazn next. Okay, and put that no check certificate in again. Okay, again, I'm not going to put in optional unless it's absolutely necessary. So let's just copy these commands to configure it. And build it. Okay, so we can run some tests. And install it. And that's about installing the API documentation, so we're not worried about that. So that's libtas and done. So now we do p11 kit, copy link, add in no check certificate. And extract it. Again, make CA is only runtime, and that's probably the next package we'll be installing by the looks of it. So that's not a problem. NSS is runtime. LFS is probably for the documentation, although I do believe we need to install that for MythTV and probably a few other packages as well. Let's just check there's no other options. Release, trust paths, hashing, users want to use a free BL library, so that's probably an optional library. No, it's not from NSS for SHA-1 and MD5 hashing. We can probably add that one in, let's try it. So now run Ninja, wait for it to build. Okay, looks like that FreeBL probably broke it, so let's ignore that. Let's do the build from the beginning again. So we need to run this again. Okay, let's build this time. So let's run the tests. All good, all passed. Let's just do su. There's a couple of commands. That's all done. And once again, we've got a link here to put in. You can see that's satisfied. Let's look at the other link that was installed, which was that one, I think. Was it? Let's look at the actual page for it, make sure I look at the right one. What was that? It was NSS, wasn't it? Okay, looks like it's the same link that it's doing. Yeah, that's the one we just looked at. Yeah, it's an identical link, so that's good to put that in there twice. So that's all okay. So that's P11 kit done. We can now move on. Oops. To make CA. So we've got the requirement, we've got an optional package here, which was NSS. And we can now download this. So as the root, so I'm going to become root straight away. So as the root user, after installing it, download the certificate source to prepare the system with the following command. There's some information there about upgrading. Okay, that's done. Now I've got cron installed at the moment, but I'm going to install that next, I think. And then we can add that in so that the certificates get updated. There's some commands here for adding additional certificates. So let's run those. Okay, that's done. There's some information there about overriding Mozilla Trust, which we don't need to do. And there's some information here about using system certificates in Python 3. Set this variable to point at them. So, for example, using that from Bash Shell. and it's got some information here about how to add that in permanently. So let's put that in. And that should be it. So the only thing we've got to keep here to do is this bit here. So the next thing we do is to go and install fcron. And I think at this point, because we've installed makeca, we should get the certificates working. So the next download, assuming it comes in from an HTTPS location, or uses that protocol rather, it should work automatically now. We should see that it will just download it without asking. So let's just checking what got to do next here. Fcron. So fcron. We'll load that up. Let's come out of this and tidy this up. So we'll do wget. Okay, it's actually HTTP, which is a bit unfortunate, but never mind. Optional is Linux PAM. We do install Linux PAM, but it's quite a bit later on. It might be a good idea to do it now, maybe. So let's do that next instead. And then I think we'll need to install, we'll need to reinstall Shadow, and we'll need to reinstall OpenSSH, as that can use it, as I remember. So let's do Linux PAM next. So let's find that. Okay. So it's got some optional dependencies here. Let me see if we actually put those in. Libnsl. The reason why I'm checking these is because some of these are actually used or required by MythTV. So although they're optional, may as well install them now if they are needed later. Okay, libturpc is, so we could do that one. Okay, right, so we'll put that one in. Yep, that's got no dependencies we need to bother about, so let's copy that. Okay. So this has got an HTTPS link, or protocol rather, so it shouldn't ask us for, or prompt us about not being able to download it, and it hasn't, it's gone away and done it. So it shows that the makeca has just automatically started working because everything's just fallen into place. So let's extract this. Okay. Yeah, we'll just copy the config as it is. Build it. And make install. So su -c make install, put the root password in, and that's done. Okay, so let's do Linux PAM now. Again, this has got HTTPS. You'll see that it will just automatically download without asking any questions or refusing to download and prompting us to add that switch to ignore the certificates. I'm not going to bother downloading the documentation again. Let me just check. Don't install the Barclay DB. I'm pretty sure we don't. No. We do actually install some of these packages later, but they're only required for documentation at the moment. So as I'm not building that, they're not going to be used at the moment. So there's no point in doing them now. Let's start building Linux PAM. We're not going to deal with the documentation. I'm not going to rebuild it myself. So let's just copy this in. Check if there's any other options we might want to put in. No. So let's run configure. And then run make. Okay, that's done. It says to test the results, you need a suitable PAMD or other configuration file, which I presume doesn't exist. But we do create one here, so it looks like we can run the tests. Right, let's do this as the root. Let's try that again. Better. Okay, now let's issue make check. Be sure the test produced no errors before continuing. The tests are very long. Redirect to an output to a log file so you can inspect it thoroughly. I wouldn't know what to look for, to be quite honest, so let's just run it and see if anything flicks past. Yeah, there's lots of green there at the moment. Yeah, that looked okay to me. Just quickly browse back. There's no failures. Everything's passing. Yeah, that looks fine. So we don't need to worry about anything. For first time installation, remove the configuration file created before. And then as a root user, install PAM and change the access for a particular file. So that's that done. Now we need to configure PAM. So they give an example file, but then they give us the details for creating some generic configuration files. And now it says you should reinstall the shadow package. So let's do that straight away next. And tidy this up. So let's download it. So this is reinstallation, but it's now because we've got PAM installed, Shadow needs to work with PAM. So requirements, Linux PAM or cracklibs, or we've got Linux PAM that fulfills that. The installation commands shown below for installations where Linux PAM has been installed and Shadow is being reinstalled to support the Linux PAM. If you're installing Shadow to provide strong password support with the cracklib library without using Linux PAM, so ensure you add the libcrack parameters to the configure script below and also issue the following command. So we're not using libcrack because it just says one or the other. So we'll just run these commands in as they are. So I don't think there'll be any other configuration commands. No, there isn't. Or configuration options. Okay. Let's build it. No test suite, so now let's install the package. And some man pages, if desired. I suppose that could be good if they're not already there. Configuring Linux PAM to work with Shadow. So we need to do all this. Copy all these scripts in to make, or configuration files rather, to configure it all correctly. And for the remaining utilities. So at this point you should do a simple test to see if Shadow is working as expected. Another terminal, open another terminal, login as root, and then run login and login as another user. So to be sure this works, I'm actually going to type it in at the terminal. It's probably the safest way of doing it, or way of proving it. So I'm going to log in. Oh, I appreciate you can't see this, but yeah, bear with me. Yep, I've logged in as root and it's worked okay. So that's all right. Instead of using etc login access for controlling access to the security system, Linux PAM uses PAM access module. Rename it to use the following. Using the following commands, we'll put that in. That's all done. And resource limits can be controlled. And that's okay. And again, it says be sure to test the login capability of the system before logging out. So once again, I'm going to try and log in as myself at the terminal. And that's worked, and I'm going to log in once more again as root. And that's worked as well, so that's fine. I'm happy with that. So that's Shadow reinstalled. Okay, so that's shadow installed, Linux PAM installed. So now let's reinstall OpenSSH. So I'll have to remember to put in with PAM into the configure command this time. So we don't need to do this because these obviously already exist. We just need to copy this, paste that in, and add in this with PAM command. And of course, it says that the test suite requires a copy of the SCP program to complete the multiplexing tests. Well, obviously, we've already got that installed automatically because we've already built and installed OpenSSH 1. So those tests should run this time. They didn't, obviously, before. So let's build this now. And we'll run the test. It says that the tests take about 20 minutes irrespective of processor speed, so we'll just run these again and wait to see what happens. Okay, let's finish. It took rather a lot longer than the 20 minutes suggested. But anyway, we can see that all the tests are passed, so that's good. So I'm going to reinstall the package. Overwrite everything that's there. Let's just take a look at this to see if that was overwritten or not. And it wasn't. So what I'm going to do is change this to no now, because I've got a normal user. Next time I log in, I can log in with a normal user and then just su to the normal user if I need to become root. So this is important, this bit. If you added Linux PAM support and you want to SSH to use it, then you'll need to add a configuration file. So it does say SSH only uses PAM to check passwords. If you disable password logins, then you don't need these commands, but it's probably best to have them there in case you do need to log in with a password. So let's put these commands in. That's done. And we don't need to worry about the boot script because obviously that's already there. So that's open SSH complete. Okay, so now we're ready to do cron so that we can add in this little script here to get the certificates updated regularly. So let's download fcron. Oops. I'm not sure if there's anything else we install that requires this, but for example, if you wanted to install PCI utilities, which might be an idea, I think that's got the script for updating the PCI database. Okay, so there's no other, it does use Linux PAM actually, but apart from that, there's nothing else. Let's add this in as the root user. And we need to reload syskloggd and then add a group and a user for fcron to use. So now we can come back to the ordinary user and start building this. Let's see if there's any other commands to put in here. Right, so without send mail, we haven't installed sendmail. Obviously, if you want to do that to get notifications from the cron, then you might want to install that first and alter that. You can set the default editor here. So you might want to do that. Stroke bin, stroke vim, I presume. Or VI, and style sheets we haven't installed, so we'll leave it at that. So we'll build this, and there's no test suite, we'll just install it. And that's done. So periodic jobs, we can add this in to create a hierarchy. So let's become root again. Paste that in. And now create a directory layout for those periodic jobs and add them to the cron tab to run. Then we've got a script to get the daemon to run automatically and to control it. And one last command here, two commands, and Looks like that started it automatically. So that's that. So let's now go to make CA and add this in as the root, and that will copy this script into the weekly updates. So that will get the new certificates. So that's done. And we'll shut that down. So there's other tools you could install at this point. You might want to install, for example, I said PCI Utils, you might want to inspect the TV hardware, make sure it looks as it should do from a hardware point of view. You might want to install GPM for mouse control. It's something I usually install. And you might want to install, for example, a text browser in case you need to access the web from the text terminal. Although, as I say, we'll be getting a GUI up at some point. So that's a couple of things you might want to do. One thing I will install now, well, a couple of packages I'll install now is sudo and rsync. Rsync's not really needed, but it can be quite useful, for example, to transfer files, for example, recordings, if you haven't got, for example, LFS set up or Samba, for example. So I'm going to start with sudo. So this is probably recommended, but rsync is probably purely optional. What happened there? Control F, sudo. There it is anyway. So let's get the package. It's got Linux PAM as a requirement, and the others we're not going to be installing, so that's okay. Okay, so let's run this configure. Don't think there's anything to add here. We don't want without PAM because we've got PAM installed, obviously, so that should be fine. And we'll build that. And now let's run the tests. And check for errors. There are none, so that's fine. So now let's install the package. So it says configuration as a file that's created. It suggests adding this. Any member of the wheel can run sudo. So let's put that in. Very simple installations, whereas only one user, it may be easy just to edit the sudo as file directly. In that case, a secure path may not be needed, and using sudo minus e can import non-privileged users' full environment into the privileged session. It says about the sudo's directory paths in lexical order, so be careful that entries in an added file do not overwrite previous entries. And if PAM is installed onto the system, we need to run this in as well. So what I'm going to do now is to run vice sudo. And in fact, what I can do even better is if I do user mod minus a minus g wheel Kernotex and add my user to the wheel group. And now if I re-log in as Kernotex and do groups, you should see that I'm now a member of wheel, which now means I should be able to do vice sudo as a sudo user. So I type in my password and you can see it's allowed me to edit the file, whereas before it wouldn't even run. And what I can do here is to, well, either edit it, or as you saw that they got us to add in a configuration file which we could use to modify the privileges for anybody in wheel, which I'm now in, or you couldn't edit it here. Let's do, it's probably safer to edit that file using vice sudo because it will actually modify it, check it for you. Let's try doing sudo vi etc sudoers. Dash sudo. So, oh, okay. It's not letting us do that. That's interesting. I wonder why that is. Oh, sudo is .d. .d. That's better. What we can add to this is a no password all, and this means that it won't continually ask me for the password each time we install a package, because obviously it remembers the password for maybe 5 minutes, but packages could be taking, you know, a bit longer than that. It'll be asking us all the time for the password every package we install. So by doing that, it would mean that it won't ask for the password at all. So that's sudo. I'm now going to install rsync. Okay, that control F is not working properly. And we've just got one dependency here to install, which is popped. So let's go back to sources, BLFS, and just tidy up sudo. And rsync is used for tests for FFmpeg, so which we install later on. So if you did want to ensure that FFmpeg is built properly, it might be worth building this anyway, even if you're not normally a user of rsync. So let's build popped. Not going to install the documentation. Let's just run the tests. That's okay. And let's install. We can do sudo now, can't we? Sudo minus c make install. That should be minus e. Okay, that's done. No documentation, so that's popped installed. And now let's install rsync. Okay, so this is if you want to run rsync as a server. So it might be an idea to put this in. I don't know if you want to run it as a server. If you don't want to run it as a server, then just leave that out. Probably can't see that happening, actually, on a box like this. So I'll just copy the configure commands And yep, we can leave that as it is. And build it. And run the test. We're not building any documentation, certainly not API documentation. Okay, 38 passed, skipped 7 for some reason. Various things not available, maybe. So that's okay. Let's now install the package. No documentation. Configuring rsync. That's for the daemon, so we're not doing that. And the boot scripts for the daemon, so that's it. That's rsync installed. And there you go. So that's basically it. What we've done in this session, on this video, is to basically install tools that part of a basic system, really. So it's Linux PAM for security, the certificates to allow us to contact and download from HTTPS protocol URLs without having to ignore the certificates. And then just a couple of helper packages such as cron for updating the certificates, and as you've just seen, rsync, as well as sudo, which is probably a good idea just because of the fact that we're going to be installing lots of packages. So it allows us to build everything as an ordinary user without risking the integrity of the system while they're being built. So the next video, we'll be getting stuck into actually starting to build the GUI, and as I go along with the GUI, I'll be showing you what happens when we try to compile MythTV. It will tell us what's missing, so it'll give us an idea of what we need to install.